Welcome to the Right to Reason podcast. I am your host, Robert Stanley. Today, we are studying the Bible with Oxford infidel Robert Shaw. Let's get started.
It's the Right to Reason podcast.
Hi, I'm Robert Shaw. I write for infidels.org, and you have the right to reason.
This episode of the Right to Reason podcast is brought to you by our patrons and contributors like me. We have all recognized the value of the unrestrained marketplace of ideas and have decided to make a difference. You can make a difference too. Contribute at patreon.com/right and learn more about your right to reason at therighttoreason.com. Your activism is appreciated.
Robert Shaw was educated at the Liverpool Bluecoat School and University College London. He also holds a Master's of Science degree from Oxford University. He has taught religious studies and classics at schools since the 2000s. You can follow him on Twitter at Mr. Robert R. Shaw. Robert Shaw, how are you, sir?
I'm fine, thank you. How are you?
Fantastic. What's the weather like in England right now?
A lot better than it has been over the course of the past sort of week or so. It's started to get a little bit warmer, but we did have a kind of January and start to February, which was bitingly cold. Mm. I'd imagine not as bitingly cold as perhaps in some parts of the States, but
I'm in Texas, so we just had that whole snowstorm thing happen here, and it is it's been crazy, but my family's been warm. We had water, we had power, so everything's okay on our end. But we're not talking about me today. We're talking about you. I really appreciate a lot of your writing at infidels.org, the secular web, a drop of reason and a pool of confusion. That's something we could use more right now for sure. Wow, you've got a couple articles here. I haven't read them all. I read The Humble Origins of the Abrahamic Religions, and that's what I was really wanting to ask you about today. But then just while we were waiting to talk, I was scrolling back through, and I started looking into another one you did, How the Early Followers of Jesus Dealt with the Unexpected Death of Their Messiah. And I was kind of wanting to maybe pop into that one a little bit. But one of the things I saw on The Humble Origins of the Abrahamic Religions was that the time that Abraham was said to have lived, they didn't have camels at that time. And that one, it just made me laugh. I literally laughed out loud when I saw that, because I thought, man, there's just so much that the way the Bible's recorded, people think that's like a history book. And they really have no idea. It's more of, I don't know, how would you describe it? A religious storybook or something.
Well, I think the rationale behind me writing that article was, I was surprised that there was very little scholarship around the kind of origins of Israel and Judah, the demythologized history of Israel and Judah. It's surprising how, up until relatively recently, a lot of the histories will talk about King David and King Solomon and the United Kingdom, and it will talk about the Exodus from Egypt and so on. And it was my attempt, really, that article, at writing a kind of demythologized history of the ancient Israelites, really, taking the kind of myth out of the Old Testament, and I think speculating, really, because all of this stuff, you know, happened 3,000 plus years ago, so we can't say with any kind of massive degree of certainty as to what happened exactly. But it's my kind of suggestion as to how the books of the Bible came about, the kind of early history of Israel and Judah, and how the ancient Israelites came about as a distinct tribe within Canaan. So it's kind of like writing a kind of history of 2,000 years or so on in 2,000 words, which is a bit of an undertaking, but you know, hopefully I've given some people a little bit of food for thought in writing it.
Absolutely. Yeah, I enjoyed the two articles I read. I grew up in the church, and they really are proud of the Dead Sea Scrolls and evangelicalism. am I correct in my understanding that that actually does legitimize at least the fact that the story was preserved accurately? Maybe not the story's accuracy, but that the story was preserved accurately.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah, I think the Dead Sea Scrolls kind of date back to around about sort of 300, 400 BCE. Hmm. And the stories are similar to kind of what's in our Bibles today. But like you say, it is, are those stories historically accurate? Now, I think that there's lots of historical truth in the Bible, and you know, the Old Testament is a useful resource in telling us about the Philistines, for example. It's useful in learning about the later kings of Israel and Judah. But I think there's most Christians, perhaps not in your country, but kind of globally, accept that there's myth in there, and there's stories which have a theological truth as opposed to a historical truth.
Hmm. A lot of what I saw, or at least what I remember from school about, or from Western Civ class, is that a lot of the times that they mentioned something like significant happening, that there was some truth to it. For example, the Old Testament will say God sends Cyrus to protect them, you know, in some way or another. And then that does have some kind of historical accuracy, because Cyrus actually took over their land, and they're technically protected from other people, but you lost to Cyrus, you know. So it's like a half truth in a way. Would that be how you would describe a lot of it?
I think the Old Testament is... I think that if you look to the later history that's in the Old Testament, this is after the Israelites had split off into two countries and become Israel and Judah. The history of the Old Testament, there is a certain consistency with the events and the people that are mentioned with other historical sources. I think the further we go back, it gets a little bit hazy. Once we're in the realms of David and Solomon, and if we go back further to Moses in the Exodus, and if we go back further than that to Abraham, then there's kind of little kind of consistency with other historical sources. These people aren't attested. Now, that's not to say that these people definitely didn't exist. It's more to say that they didn't seem to make their mark in other historical documents from outside Israel.
They found the same amount of books of Genesis as they did the Book of Enoch and the Dead Sea Scrolls, and yet they don't have the Book of Enoch in our Old Testament. And I wonder why that is. Where was it? And all the others, this is chapter 7. Verse 1, and all the others together with them took unto themselves wives, and each chose for himself one. He's talking about angels here. And it says, I think what was described, because Enoch's referenced a lot in the Old Testament, and I think whenever other authors were referencing Enoch or talking about the same topic, they would say sons of God or something like that, maybe as an angelic reference. But here it says,
oh, right, okay.
They taught them charms and enchantments and the cutting of roots and made them acquainted with plants. And they became pregnant and they bare great giants whose height was 3,000 ells. I don't know what an ell is. Who summoned all the acquisitions of...
Well, same. I don't know what ells are myself.
Oh, yeah. Maybe it's like, what was the cubits or something? Whatever, like the length of the arm.
Is it, yeah.
Maybe it's something.
Well, the Book of Enoch is quite a late arrival on the scene. So it's said to be written by Noah's great-grandfather.
Are you there? You just bleeped out on me.
Oh, right.
What a shame. This is not...
Hello, can you hear me now?
Yeah, you're back now.
I'm wondering whether I could... should I try another device?
Sure, that might help. That might help.
Yeah, okay. Let me do that then.
Are you changed from your computer to your phone, I'm guessing?
To an iPad, so we'll see how we get on with that.
Fantastic. You were just telling us about how Enoch was written a bit later than the other books.
Yeah, I mean, it's one of the books which seems to come on the scene kind of around about 300, 200 BC, something like that. And I think what you can see in the Book of Enoch is the influence of Persian thought in the Book of Enoch. So the Persians believe that there was an almighty deity, but the almighty deity had an adversary. So in Persian thought, the almighty deity is Ahura Mazda, and Ahura Mazda has an adversary called Angra Mainyu, that explains why bad things happen to people who are good people. And that seems to be taken on in the Book of Enoch. So the Persians controlled Judah a couple of centuries before the birth of Christ. And we can see the influence of Persian thought in the Book of Enoch, in that it explains the origins of Satan as being a kind of fallen angel that used to serve God but decided to rebel against him. And there's the echoes of the kind of Persian story about Ahura Mazda and Angra Mainyu in the Book of Enoch. So it's quite late on in what we call the Second Temple period, 200, 300 BCE, something like that. But there's some quite weird and wonderful stories in the Book of Enoch, as you know.
Yeah, that's why I figured they didn't add it with the rest of them. It's just because, like, what I was reading earlier is talking about angels having sex with women and creating giants. I think another part referenced angels having sex with animals and having animal-angel hybrids. And, so, and I thought, well,
angel-human hybrids, yes.
Yeah, and something about Satan had helped us, like he taught us how to lie or something like that. I can't remember what it was.
Oh, right, okay.
It didn't kind of line up with the others, which is funny because that's not a reason that you should discount a book. You know, just because, it doesn't fit the narrative that we want to present, seem like a justifiable reason to exclude it whenever it had just as many copies as the others, you know, like Exodus or Genesis or what have you.
Yeah. And I think, you know, even at the time, the idea that Noah's great-grandfather had written such an extensive piece of literature, possibly even at that time, seemed a little bit far-fetched, maybe. So that's, you know, possibly why, another reason why it's not kind of accepted as in the canon of Jewish scriptures.
Speaking of not fitting the narrative, so you have to make stuff up or exclude things or add things, the story of Jesus Christ is one of those perfect examples where you had written the Gospels didn't really have all these prophetic things of the coming Messiah like Christians would like to argue. But you gave a few examples, and I was hoping you could tell us some of them, but where they had referenced Psalms amongst other books and just shoved Old Testament writings into the stories of the Gospels to kind of validate Christ's messianic title.
Yeah, that's right. And I think if we look at the Gospels, I think Matthew was one of the people who does that quite a lot. If we read Matthew's Gospel, it seems like that in, you know, every a few verses, there's a reference to an Old Testament prophecy that is being fulfilled. And what Matthew seems to have done is that he's gone to the Old Testament, he's looked at Messianic prophecy, and he's looked at verses which were predictions of the Messiah. And he also takes some other passages from the Old Testament as well, treats them as if they were Messianic prophecy, and creates his story, his narrative about Jesus to almost fulfill as many prophecies as possible. So, I mean, there are some prophecies, genuine Messianic prophecies, for example, the fact that the Messiah was said to have been born in Bethlehem. So Matthew has the story in his gospel of Jesus being born in Bethlehem. But there's other bits and pieces as well. For example, when Jesus is tried, he's silent. He doesn't say a word. What Matthew does is he claims that it's the fulfillment of a prophecy in Isaiah. He did not open his mouth. Now, if we go back to that verse, that passage in Isaiah, it's not messianic prophecy. It's talking about how Israel and Judah were oppressed. It's not looking forward to kind of the life of the Messiah.
Yeah, I noticed at one part how the early followers of Jesus dealt with the unexpected death of their Messiah. And you say, according to the Gospel of Mark, Jesus quotes the first line of this psalm from the cross, my God, why have you forsaken me? And then Mark says, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani. I don't know if I pronounced that correctly, but it's not necessarily fulfilling a prophecy. You know, it's prophetic in the sense that he's saying the same thing from the psalm. So if he actually said it, that's cool, but that's not necessarily as at least the way I was raised in fundamentalism is, oh, look, there's more evidence lines this up. But it's like, well, that's not evidence of anything. That's evidence that either Jesus and or Mark read psalms. You know,
I think an explanation for that passage being there is that either Jesus did say it, and it's reasonable if he was an observant Jew that he would have been familiar with the Psalms. And that whole psalm is a kind of cry to God from somebody who's being oppressed, someone who's in bad circumstances. So it might be historical. And, you know, the fact that it's in Aramaic in the Gospels as well, possibly, might lead us to believe that he did actually say it. But there's also the possibility that, again, the gospel writers have gone to that particular passage and have put it into their narrative of the crucifixion to say, hey, look, this was all prophesied hundreds of years ago in the Psalms. Whereas the Psalms weren't kind of predictions. They weren't prophecy about the Messiah at all. You know, they weren't kind of songs and hymns that were sung in the Jerusalem temple. They weren't kind of looking forward to a Messiah at all, really. So, I said, I think someone can look at all of these references to the Old Testament in the gospel narrative of Jesus and think to themselves, you know, wow, all of these things were prophesied and they happened. But I think a more rational kind of interpretation is to say that when the gospel when the gospel writers were writing their gospels, they were trying to sell the idea of Jesus as the Messiah, and they were probably having a bit of a hard time because Jewish people had expected a king, a warrior king, who was going to usher in world peace and rule the world from the Jerusalem temple. And here we've got the early Christians trying to claim that somebody who was crucified is the Messiah. So I think in order to try and sell the idea that Jesus was the Jewish Messiah, they had to look for these prophecies and look for prophecies that weren't there in some cases, that do you look to passages which weren't prophecies and have Jesus fulfill them in the Gospels.
Do you think he actually existed, Jesus Christ?
I think yes. I'm conscious of the whole Jesus mythicism movement. And I think we need to go refer to Occam's razor for deciding whether Jesus was historical. I think, you know, the simple explanation is the true one, in that we have all of these stories about Jesus. We've also got the fact that he was crucified, and, you know, why would they make up the story of a kind of crucified Messiah? So I think we need to go for the most reasonable explanation, in that there was a historical person called Jesus. I think it's quite telling that kind of university theology departments don't seem to be attracted to the idea of Jesus mythicism. And
I
think that when I see Jesus mythicists being interviewed and speaking, it seems to me that they've got this preconceived idea that Jesus was didn't exist, and then they look for evidence to support that, as opposed to going to where the evidence takes them.
It's like
seems to border on conspiracy theory sometimes, I think, some of the kind of methods used by the Jesus mythicists.
Yeah, it's like atheism taking it a little farther. Like, they're not just happy enough with there not being a god. They got to take away some dude named Yeshua 2,000 years ago as well. And, the way I look at it, I guess a lot of people might call me a mythicist. I'm not in that camp, I don't think. I assume it's an amalgam of many stories of many men that were alive at the time. And I'm sure there was a focal figure that most of this applies to, but the stories were probably from...
I think so, too.
Okay. Well, that's comforting that someone from your level of education on the topic thinks something similar that I do. And, you know, makes me feel a little better, because I'm surrounded within the atheist movement with mythicists. And anytime I talk to them, you know, that I bring up the same point you do, of like, well, academia doesn't really tend to support it. And on top of that,
and that's,
they don't really seem to care.
That's not a reason in itself to reject it, of course.
Sure.
The fact that academia don't support it. But I don't know. I just seem, it seems like a lot of these people are trying to be kind of shocking in defending something which seems a kind of a little bit outrageous, really. But yeah. I don't subscribe to it. I've read the books of Richard Carrier on this topic. I'm not sure whether you have or not, but
I dabble.
So some of the explanations that he comes up with, it's very kind of very convoluted, and you know, I think with the evidence that we have, you know, and the fact that there's evidence of Christianity and existing quite early on in the first century, I just can't see how it would happen if it was a kind of person that had been made up.
Another author that likes to write on that topic is David Fitzgerald, and
yeah,
we've had him on a few times, and one of my favorite episodes is him talking to a Christian apologist that regularly frequents the show named Kelly Clemenson, and every time Kelly says something false, David interrupts him, and Kelly gets completely pissed off.
Yeah.
I feel bad for it, because it's an example of how just poor a moderator I am, but it is hilarious to listen to. Another guest, former guest and a Christian apologist, wrote something that I wanted to read to you. Caleb Graves was talking to me about some of the concerns that he has with the prophecies that Jesus made. And he says, when I read the Gospels in high school, or read the Gospels in high school, I was troubled by passages that explicitly said the end of days would occur within the lifetime of the disciples. It still troubles me today. In Matthew 24:3, and remember, this is a Christian writing this, so I appreciate the honesty, because, you know, I'm thinking, yeah, but I'll finish it, you'll see my point. Matthew 24:3, the disciples ask, what will be the sign of your coming and of the end of the age? Jesus describes the destruction of the temple, verse 4-18, and then says that immediately, that's verse 19, after the, I quote, stars will fall from the sky, which is just in quote there, but just a ridiculous concept, you know, from not somebody that would be a deity, as I was taught, stars falling from, you know, like the size of the star isn't even understood by this guy that's supposed to be omniscient incarnate. Regardless, after the stars will fall from the sky, and they, quote, see the Son of Man coming in the clouds of heaven, end quote. In other words, immediately after the fall of the temple in 70 CE, Christ was supposed to return. That is why Jesus could say, when you see here, etc. To clarify this, Jesus says that this generation will certainly not pass away until all things have happened. So, I mean, that to me, I appreciate the confession of doubt from a believer, you know, that can actually say that. I don't know why you would still hold on to your faith thereafter, but if you're aware of this problem, but regardless, that should be enough right there, I would think, Robert, that we could say.
I think it's quite interesting that the gospel writers that include that saying of Jesus is Mark and Matthew, like you say, and they're the, as far as most of kind of scholars are concerned, they're the first two gospels to have been written, that that before all of the disciples are dead, the Son of God will return and so on. And in the later gospels, Luke and John, there's no kind of saying from Jesus that where he says something like that. It's almost like kind of the writers of the later Gospels, Luke and John, were kind of conscious of the fact that, hang on, this hasn't happened. So we don't have Jesus saying anything like that in Luke and John. And it's interesting as well that in Mark, which most scholars think is the first gospel to have been written, Jesus talks about a kingdom of God, that there is going to be literally a kingdom ruled by a king, and Jesus is going to be the king of that kingdom. Yeah. And later gospels, it becomes a more kind of spiritual thing. You know, the kingdom of God becomes something which is a bit more spiritual as opposed to a literal kingdom. But you're right. I mean, in the early gospels, he says that, you know, everything is going to happen before you all pass away, and it didn't happen.
Oh yeah, I work in my day job in pharmaceuticals. a surprisingly large number of Mormons in Texas.
Okay.
I don't know how that occurs, but they seem to move toward the Austin area, perhaps. But because I challenged my coworkers with this very point, and the Mormons just have the best defense for it, in my opinion. It doesn't validate their religion in any way, but it certainly solves so many problems that you and I have talked about thus far. Is they say,
sure.
Oh, well, the Bible's not inerrant. It was written by men, but we have, you know, the golden plates from Moroni, the angel.
Okay, so we have been corrupted.
Right. We have the original one, even though it came after all the others. That's just what men wrote, and it's very helpful, very useful. You know, which kind of makes me wonder, like, well, if the thing that Moroni wrote, you believe in that because of Jesus Christ, and Jesus Christ is because of the Old Testament, but all the Jesus Christ and Old Testament stuff isn't accurate, then the whole reason you believe in your new faith, which is actually the old faith, you know, what's the point? You know, but that seems obvious to me, but I don't know. Are there other things that you would say might blow people's mind about both the Old and New Testament that historically just doesn't seem to line up?
Well, I'm in the process at the moment of, looking into the Exodus. And I'm writing a piece for Infidels at the moment. And, the Exodus is something which is celebrated in millions of American households each year with the Passover Seder meal and so on. And, Jews and Christians continue to view it as historical fact. I think in addition to the fact that there doesn't seem to be any kind of historical confirmation for the Exodus, I've been looking into kind of who ruled Canaan at the time the Exodus is supposed to have happened, and I've been kind of looking into kind of Egyptian history as well. Traditionally, the pharaoh that is said to have liberated the Jews is said to have been Ramesses the Great. And if you look at the Prince of Egypt and the Ten Commandments, Cecil B. DeMille, it's Ramesses the Great. But if Ramesses the Great released all of these kind of people into Egypt, a lot of the cities and towns that they're said to have gone into were deserted at the time of Ramesses the Great. Now, if you look at Jericho, for example, Jericho was deserted between 1400 BC and about 800-900 BCE. So if the Israelites are moving en masse and conquering Jericho, Jericho was uninhabited at the time of Ramesses the Great. If you go earlier, and a lot of people get round to that problem and say, oh, the Exodus was a lot earlier. It happens around 1400 BCE, much earlier than Ramesses. Then you've got the problem that Canaan is a very tightly controlled Egyptian province up until about 12,000 BCE. So, if the Israelites are leaving en masse and there's 600,000 of them with their wives and children and livestock and so on, they're essentially crossing the Red Sea, or the Sea of Reeds, to translate it correctly. They're leaving Egypt. They're escaping the Egyptian army to go into another Egyptian province that is very kind of tightly run by the pharaohs at the time. So I'm kind of trying to find if there's any kind of period in Egyptian history that the Exodus can be fit into, but it just can't. As well as the fact that the lack of archaeological evidence for millions of people crossing from Egypt into Canaan, and there's no kind of record of it in Egyptian writings. It just doesn't seem to fit in with what we know about the region at that particular point in history. So, that's the kind of thing that I'm looking into at the moment. And it's problematic, I think, if you want to see the Exodus as being a historical event, it throws up so many problems.
And the short distance from, I'm assuming, Cairo to the Promised Land, they wandered 40 years.
Well, 40 years. And if you're in the desert for 40 years as well, you're going to leave some sort of trace. And archaeologists have found traces of people who were living 1,000 years before the Israelites are said to have moved to Canaan from Egypt. They're able to find traces of kind of quite small groups of nomads, but traces of some 2 million people going from Egypt to Canaan is they haven't found. Now, interestingly as well, Jesus talks about the Exodus as being historical. You know, Jesus talks about Adam and Eve as being historical as well. So
while you're talking here, I'm typing in the location. I want to see exactly the distance. It's such a short. Let me see here. I want to do.
I think if you were kind of walking it, it would take you quite a long time.
All right. So walking from Cairo to Canaan is 41 hours.
Oh, right. Okay.
That can't be right.
Well, of course, the Bible frames it as being a
that can't be
a
right.
kind of punishment for disobedience and unbelief, doesn't it? So that's the explanation.
I guess, but
for the kind of 40 years.
That's nuts. I get. Well, maybe we have roads now that there weren't. There would be roads that even back then, though, right?
There'd be paths of some description, I'm sure.
That is so crazy, and it looks like they do cross a river. It doesn't record it as the Red Sea. It just says it's the Nile. So I guess
I think that the Red Sea is a kind of is a mistranslation. Okay. Sea of Reeds, I think, is the literal translation from the Hebrew, which became Red Sea.
That's just part of the Nile, then. Looks like
no idea. I think people are still sort of debating where the Sea of Reeds is to this day. I think, but
it's such a ridiculous story. I don't understand. It is such a focal point of all Jewish history and Christian history.
Well, so indeed, yes.
I don't understand how that happens.
You know, I think many Christians, beginning to kind of interpret it as a kind of allegory, or it's there to communicate theological truths as opposed to historical truths. And I think some portions of the kind of Jewish community are kind of realizing that it's a bit of a step to actually see this as historical based on what we know now from the histories of Egypt and the history of Israel and Judah.
Let me run something past you. I've been wanting to ask you ever since we were talking via email. One of our patrons is named Bernard Lambrell, and he wrote this book, quite a long title, The Covenant on the Origin of the Abrahamic Faith by Means of Deification. But one of the chapters in this book is saying that when Sodom and Gomorrah was punished by God via fire, and he leveled their city, presumably because of their homosexuality, that's at least how it seems to be written. Maybe, you know, if you look at the Old Testament, he was really mad about the angels attempting to rape his angels. But the way that modern evangelicals in the U.S. interpret it is, you know, that's gays. That's why they were punished, was for being gay. And that's just a very common Christian understanding of that story. But he says what actually happened is that was Cyrus sending two of his, whenever you, like a messenger, right? It was like in that movie 300. You know, where he sends
a city messenger.
Yeah, like don't shoot the messenger. Or he says that he had actually sent these two messengers to the city, but instead of like King Leonidas and 300, you know, kicking somebody into a well or a hole or something, that they raped these men, and that was what was so offensive. They raped them and then sent them back. So it wasn't necessarily that the city was homosexual; it was that the act was homosexual in nature, but as a disrespect. Whatever, you know, his messengers return to Cyrus and tell him what happened, he then levels the cities because he's so angry about how he treated his messengers. And I don't know what evidence he has for that, but it's certainly a fascinating story. And I kind of wanted to pick your brain about if you had heard something similar, or if there are similar stories about times that God was have said to have done something, but it was actually just, you know, Cyrus or some other great king doing it.
Okay, I mean, I'm not familiar with that interpretation of Sodom and Gomorrah, to be quite honest. I know that some people see it more to do with kind of being welcoming to strangers, and it's a tale about, you know, God punishes them because they're not welcoming, as opposed to it being about sexual morality. But
are there other examples that you would say where there's just historically, yeah, that might have happened, but it wasn't necessarily God?
Yeah, of course, lots of things. I mean, certainly when Israel, ancient Israel, is invaded by the Assyrians, for example. You know, it's a historical fact. The Bible interprets it as being God's punishment for Israel for going off and worshipping other gods. You know, similarly, when Judah is exiled and all of the kind of the Jewish elite are exiled to Babylon, the reason given for that is the fact that they had started worshipping other gods. So I think we can see there's a lot of cases in the Old Testament where there are kind of historical facts, but they kind of have a supernatural explanation. It's God punishing or rewarding. I think with Sodom and Gomorrah, possibly there might be a kind of folk memory of a couple of cities that were destroyed, maybe. But, you know, I think it's going back a lot further. And like I say, it might have been part of the folk memory of the Israelites. And again, we've got a kind of supernatural take on it. You know, it could have been two cities that were destroyed for natural reasons, but a supernatural explanation is given to it.
What if that's just man's progression, Rob, where you're, you know, even before Babylon and Mesopotamian lands, you know, they had explanations for the origin of everything, right? And everything was, there was some kind of supernatural explanation for the universe or, you know, a lot of, what was it, that cave in Spain where they found, the cave painting showed that the whole universe was created from an egg, you know, and then the egg breaks. And that's some might argue symbolic of the Big Bang, you know, as if they could have knowledge of that back then. But, you know, it's still fascinating and fun. But then you go a little bit farther and now we're using supernatural explanations with the Old Testament to explain historical events, which, you know, we don't really do that so much anymore. But maybe that was just our progression at the time. But you go on a little bit farther, we use supernatural explanations to explain weather events. But, you know, once again, we've moved past those three examples, but mankind still wants to use supernatural explanations to explain intuitive feelings or loss of loved one or coincidences, conspiracies. So it's like we're still in our adolescence in a way.
And I think that a number of people have suggested an evolutionary reason as to why we kind of attribute things happening to someone or something is that it's in our DNA to look for agency in things. You know, if you're walking in the forest and twig snaps or something like that, you assume that it's a kind of Mad Axe murderer is coming after you. It probably isn't, but to our ancient ancestors, kind of attributing agency and, you know, a being has caused this sound would have helped them and helped them to survive. It would have helped them to evade kind of things and people that might have killed them and predators and so on and so forth. So there's the argument that we've still got that to this day, that we will continue because it's kind of a part of our genetic makeup to look at events and think that something is controlling them or something's making them happen. It's caused kind of the need to explain things by agency. Absolutely. And, you know, we will continue to have it. We'll continue to think that someone or something has caused this or a being has caused this event to happen or a being is intervening in our lives.
Robert Shaw, I've really enjoyed talking to you today and I appreciate your time. Anybody wants to find his blog, that is at infidels.org. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you to London Rob. Thank you to Dave Blair at DaveBlairMusic.com. Thank you to FeedSpot.com for promoting The Right to Reason to the Top 10 Atheist Podcasts. Thank you to our patrons, Jason Parker, FreeThinker215, Alan Marks, Philip Spawn, Bernard Lamborel, Enema Man, Larry Wilson, and our top supporter, Rob Montgomery. You can support this broadcast at patreon.com/right and learn more at therighttoreason.com. Next week, we are talking to John Gleason, the godless engineer. Between now and then, remember that you have the right to reason.
بارون نمیاد هیچ وقت ولی خیامون نخیصه. گاوای میانه رو در حال مذاکره با رئیس کارخونه سوسیس. مرتضی مرتضی